I want to thank you for downloading or streaming this message from Victory. We believe that the starting point for real life change is centered around God's word lived out with God's people. So no matter who you are or where you are or what you're struggling with, our goal is to inspire and equip you with a new perspective that will give you a better way to do life. And we pray that as you live out God's word, you will truly experience something more, something better. And if you haven't experienced a live Victory service yet, we invite you to visit victorycc.life for more information on when and where you can join us. No matter where you are in the world, you can tune in with us through Victory Everywhere. That's what we're calling our online campus, Victory Everywhere. Or if you're local, we'd love to have you join us here in person. Here at Victory, we're contributors, not just consumers, and we consider it a privilege to give back what God has so freely given us. We celebrate generosity and the work that God does with our sacrificial giving, and in our community and around the world. Now, if the message that you are about to hear helps you, inspires you, and challenges you in any way, we invite you to partner with us financially in our vision of connecting people back to God. Join us by going to victorycc.life/give. Thank you again for watching. We hope you enjoy this message.
Jesus commands us to love our neighbors as ourselves. You're probably thinking, easier said than done, right? Who is my neighbor? What did Jesus mean by neighbor anyway? We're well-intentioned in sharing the love of Jesus, but if we're honest, we're not usually sure where to begin. We've tried things that didn't work or that just felt downright awkward. So how do we best share the love of Jesus with those around us? Well, Jesus tells us. Better yet, he shows us by using 5 simple practices that Jesus demonstrates throughout the Gospels. We can learn how to bless our neighbor. When we bless our neighbor, we love our neighbor. And a love like that could change the world again. So how do we love our neighbor? B.L.E.S.S.
Last year was a really, really hard year for a lot of reasons. And we all know it didn't just affect our country. It was a global phenomenon that affected the entire world. Everybody was getting it, and it was spreading kind of crazy. And I'll be honest, in the beginning, I didn't really understand it. But what I do know is that it affected everything and it caused everything to kind of stand still. Time didn't seem to really exist anymore. Our normal routines had been interrupted. And, you know, I didn't really understand it at first, but people around me started getting it. In fact, I work with teenagers and a lot of students actually got it. And I was convinced I wasn't. I was determined not to get it. But it wasn't far into 2020, and I did get it. I went ahead and I downloaded TikTok. And let me tell you, does that kill time? It has this unique ability to be able to make you think that you're only on it for 10 minutes, and then you look up and it's 3 in the morning. And so time really does kind of get away from you. In fact, there were several times Chelsea and I, you know, there's a lot of trash at first, and once you get through the algorithm and train it, how to present things to you that you think is funny, oh man, we'd be laughing our heads off and look up, and it is the middle of the night, it's 3 in the morning, we're adults, we should probably go to bed. And so TikTok kind of consumed a lot of last year for us. I'm recovering now, so I'm doing a lot better, but you know, one of my favorite TikToks are the misheard lyrics, the famous pop songs that, like, you hear, and maybe your whole life you've been singing the wrong lyrics, something like this.
I'm friends with the monster that's under my bed. I wish that I could be like the cool kids, cause all the cool kids, they seem to fit in. I'll get you freak on. Shout out to my ex. He in love with some other chick.
I wanna hold your hand.
14K.
That's my favorite.
I'm 14K.
Kicking your can all over the place.
And just like that, we're out of time this morning, so no, just kidding. So we all know what it's like to mishear something. Maybe you've had a phrase that you thought was one thing your whole life until you said it somewhere and somebody corrected you and you realized the actual phrase is something entirely different. So the principle that we're going to be discussing today, for all intents and purposes, is something few people master. We're in this series, it's called B.L.E.S.S., and we're talking about five different principles of how to bless those around you, bless your neighbor. We're going through a book that goes with it, so if you have not gotten a copy of the book, we got them out there by the connection desk. I encourage you to go out there and get it after service. And last week, Josh kicked off this series with the letter B, and it just means to begin with prayer. If you want to bless those around you, you got to begin with prayer. And today we're continuing in this principle, but before I give you the next principle in this series, I have to give a disclaimer and warn you, because this principle is so powerful that the disclaimer is you're not supposed to use it manipulatively for your own selfish gain, okay? I'm gonna teach you this, and it's gonna give you this incredible influence over the people around you in a way that you did not have before. It's subtle, but every person will gravitate towards you in the room that you walk in if you master this principle. It's super powerful because it can get you promoted. It can help you swoon the ladies. It can increase your sales performance. This principle is so powerful that I have to give the disclaimer, we're doing this to bless others, okay? It's not for yourself. The principle we're going to be discussing today is mastering the art of listening. And we have to learn how to listen really, really well if we want to have any kind of impact in anybody else's lives. And just to be clear, again, we're not asking you to use this for your own selfish gain, but we're trying to bless others. And we're not trying to convert them, right? Converting is just to cause to adopt a different religion or political doctrine or opinion, etc. To bless is just to enact a good of any kind. And so the purpose of this is to bless those around you. And this is going to be super applicable. This whole sermon is basically an application sermon today. So whatever stage of life you're in, wherever you're at, whether you're a Christian or not, a Buddhist, atheist, apathetic about all that, wherever you stand, whatever your beliefs are, this is going to be an incredibly powerful tool for you to have on your tool belt to just be able to be a better husband, better wife, better leader, better friend, better person. You will be the best person in the room if you can master the art of listening and if you can listen well. But if you're a Christ follower, then this isn't just a good tool to have. This is a requirement. This is absolutely essential. If we want to present the gospel to people, if we want to have any influence in people's lives for the sake of God, then what we have to do is master the art of listening. I think this is why James, the brother of Jesus, says in his letter to the early church, he says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry." The idea of and the ability to listen well is so incredibly rare in our culture today, and it's so radical because there is so much noise. There's so much noise, and nobody listens well. Imagine if your spouse put down the phone long enough to look you in the eye and pay you the attention you so desperately want and deserve. Imagine if our politicians would stop agendaing long enough to listen to the opposing view and actually come up with a solution about the issues rather than setting up their opponents as a straw man argument and shouting over them. Imagine if the person in the drive-thru stopped multitasking long enough to hear your order right the first time. Would that change your perspective, your attitude towards humanity? Say amen. Now imagine how your listening would change the hearts and the minds of those that you interact with in the same way, because you have that power if you master the art of listening. And listening is a lost art for some of the reasons that I mentioned, but it's an art. That's why when you go to school to become a counselor, a therapist, there's hours and hours of classes that you have to take to learn how to listen well. Not interject every time you want to say something, but to listen and listen well. To try to diagnose what's actually being said and come to the root of an issue, listening well is really tough. And we all know how important this is. We all know how influential and powerful this can be, because all of us in this room know what it feels like to not be heard. We all know the frustration of being misunderstood. I think there are few things in life that are more frustrating than being misrepresented or misunderstood, feeling like people don't get you. And if you master the art of listening, this will radically change the way you interact with people. I like to think of myself as a pretty good listener, and because I have this really cool ability. Husbands, hopefully you can back me up on this. I have this really cool ability to be able to regurgitate anything that I hear within 10 seconds. So I can be on my computer or my phone or just doing something else, and Chelsea can be talking to me, and she'll suddenly stop and say, "Are you listening to me?" And I'll say, "Yeah," and then I'll regurgitate whatever she just said. Even if I have no idea what that was, it just comes out. And she looks at me and she goes, "I need you to show me you're listening to me." Right? How many of you've gotten this from your spouse? Be honest. Like, "I need you to show me. Prove it." Right? Look me in the eye and show me that you're listening. Right? And so what we're going to talk about today is principles that we can discover in order to do this really, really well and to master the art of listening. A lot of times we try to solve the wrong issues because we fail to listen. If you are reading the book, maybe you've read this chapter. I'm pretty sure this is in the book. But there's a pretty influential Christian leader, speaker named Michael Frost. And he's most known for talking on subjects of missions and evangelism. And he talks about this group of missionaries that went to the slums in India in order to try to help this village of people. And so they come and they're like, "Hey, we can build churches. We can build schools. We got all these resources to give you. What would you like us to do? What would help your community the most?" And they go, "Well, we'd like a mailbox." And they're like, "Okay, great, mailbox. Check. What else? Again, we can do all these things." And they're like, "No, just a mailbox is fine." And so intrigued, they dig a little deeper and they ask, "Well, why just a mailbox? Why stop there? Again, we can build you things. We got all these resources." And they're like, "Well, because in India, if you don't have a mailbox, then you don't have a zip code. If you don't have a zip code, then you're not on the map and you don't exist, and therefore are ineligible for any kinds of social services, including schools, medical clinics, or whatever else that they could get, because they don't exist, because they don't have a zip code, because they don't have a mailbox. So what we really need is a mailbox to get us on the map." And if they hadn't stopped to listen, all the effort that they had poured towards them would kind of have been a waste. And it took a couple of years for them to work through the bureaucracy of getting them a mailbox and putting them on the map. But once they were there, that community began to radically change. Listening is a lost art, and if we can learn to do it well, then we can change the world. The next step to blessing our neighbors is to listen. And Jesus shows us several principles that we can use to guide us, because Jesus was the master at the art of listening. And there was no one better than him. And in fact, it's unique because Jesus was God, right? So if we're Christians, we believe he's God in the flesh. And if anyone should have been listening, it was us or the people around him listening to him. But Jesus shows us what it means to truly master the art of listening. And so we can look all throughout the Gospels to find these principles repeated over and over and over again. But today, we're going to hone into Luke chapter 18, starting in verse 35. And we're going to read through the whole thing first, and then we'll kind of dig in and dissect it a little bit and go a little deeper. So as Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He called out, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see," he replied. Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. And when all the people saw it, they also praised God. So the first thing that we can learn about listening when it comes to Jesus is that listening is the best way to show love. Listening can show love, and it shows love without prejudice. What you need to understand about this culture in that day is that the blind beggar, he was ostracized by his community. See, most people believed that it was either because of his sin or his parents' sin that he was disabled in this way. And therefore, he was an outcast. He was untouchable. You do not associate with him. You do not talk with him. You do not eat with him. You do not do anything with him. But Jesus loved without prejudice. And time after time after time, we see this played out through the Gospels. Author and theologian, Christian counseling expert David Augsburger says it this way. He says, being heard is so close to being loved that for the average person, they are almost indistinguishable. The first step to listening well is to love without prejudice. Jesus showed this with Zacchaeus, who was a tax collector and despised by his own people, the blind man from John 5, the Samaritan woman from John 4, the woman caught in adultery from John 8, the sinful woman who poured expensive perfume on his feet from Luke 7, and even his own disciples like Matthew, another tax collector despised by his own community. Jesus loved without prejudice. So sometimes what we have to do if we want to learn to listen well is to love without prejudice. The second thing that we find Jesus does often is he inquires the people. He asks lots of leading questions. He asks them. He digs a little bit deeper. If we go back to verse 41, he says, what do you want me to do for you? Lord, I want to see, he replied. How often do we assume what the other person wants and we miss the mark because of our assumptions? Like the missionaries in India, they assumed that they had what they needed. But if we ask the right questions, if we inquire, it shows that we're beginning to master the art of listening. If someone says, you know, ask them how they're doing, I'm okay. Well, inquire, oh, how come just okay? Anything else going on? You know, if they say they're good, then great. What's great about life right now? And then if they say, well, honestly, I'm not doing too great. Well, then go ahead and ask those questions. Inquire about their life. Don't just wave and great, move on. The third thing that Jesus did was he stopped. He didn't let the busyness of his schedule get in the way of seeing people. Going back to verse 39, we see that those who led the way rebuked the blind man and told him to be quiet, and he shouted all the more, and Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. Most people would have just moved on, but Jesus didn't. He loved without prejudice, and he stopped to notice people. When I was in Bible college, they had this mantra that they repeated all throughout the school and all our classes, and they said, who we teach you to love is more important than what we teach you to know. And I was in all kinds of Bible classes, ministry-type classes, practical classes, pastoral counseling classes, and the stuff that they repeated over and over and over again was that people are opportunities, not interruptions. Which is really hard when you're a task-oriented person and you've got a lot of things to get done. But people are opportunities, not interruptions, and if every Christian took that literally, then we would start to see a difference in our world. Next thing that Jesus is constantly doing is he's testing what's being said, what's happening, and he has this way of drawing out what's really inside of people, drawing out what's going on underneath the surface. In fact, you could just assume that what you see on the surface is not the whole story. That sometimes what you see on the surface is a pretty accurate reflection of how someone's feeling. And again, you can inquire as to how why that is, but more often than not, what you see on the outside is not always what's going on the inside. And so test, draw out what's going on within people. Sometimes when people are displaying on the outside, maybe it's anger, they're testing your patience. If we allow that to be the trigger to make us stop in our tracks and regulate ourselves and not what they call in the counseling world is transference. Stop the transference and recognize maybe there's something else going on underneath the surface that I don't know. So test and change your mindset. Test that what they are saying is actually what they are saying. Because oftentimes the anger that's misdirected at you is because of something else. And when you say, oh, I'm so sorry. You know, this seems like it's not that big of a deal. Is there something else that's going on? And is there anything I can do to help? When you test, then you'll start to get better answers. The fifth thing that we can learn from Jesus is the way that he engaged with people. Jesus stayed in the moment as he ministered to people. And what we need to recognize about listening is that listening requires a response. We have to engage with people. It's not good enough to just smile and nod or regurgitate the thing you heard in the last 10 seconds. You have to actually engage. You have to respond. And I think oftentimes we don't do this because we're afraid we're going to have the wrong answer. We're going to say the wrong thing. If anybody's ever talked to somebody who is mourning or going through grief, there is never the right thing to say. And that's okay. Your job isn't to say the right thing when you're trying to actively listen to somebody. Your job is to give them room to speak and to validate what they are going through. Respond in a loving way, even if it's not an insightful answer. Here's the reality, and it greatly disappoints me because I'm someone who speaks publicly often, but people will very rarely remember what you say. What they'll remember is how you made them feel. So even if you say the word about saying the wrong thing, if you can acknowledge, so I hear you saying this. So what you're saying is, and then summarize what they just said to you. It's easy as that. And that will, they can either feel validated and yes, and that's so frustrating. I'm so sorry you're going through this. Nobody should have to go through this. Nobody should have to go through this alone. I'm sorry. And in that conversation, you begin to bear the weight of their burdens by just empathizing and listening, giving them room to process their emotions and say things out loud. Jesus showed examples of this all the time throughout the Gospels where he's engaging with the people. In fact, just earlier in Luke 18, all the children were coming to him, and even some of the disciples were like, no, get them away, they're interrupting, you know. And Jesus was like, no, let them come. And he starts getting on their level and engaging with them. I always just imagine Jesus asking them questions and, you know, what's your favorite rock game to play? Because I probably didn't have, like, I don't know. But anyway, I sometimes wonder what that looked like. But what we see time and time again is Jesus engaging with the people he interacted with. And Jesus demonstrated a life of listening to his heavenly Father. So when he nudged people into action, he knew what he was asking of them. And oftentimes, I mentioned earlier, we're going through this so that we can learn how to bless people, not to convert them. And often when we come at people with the goal of converting them, what we're trying to do is nudge them before we've done any of the other stuff. We haven't shown love to them. We haven't developed a relationship with them. We haven't gotten to know their story. We haven't engaged with them. We haven't inquired about their lives. And when we jump straight to nudging someone, we don't have any relational equity to be able to make any kind of influence in somebody's life. And often you'll rub them the wrong way. But what Jesus demonstrates is that when you learn how to listen well, master the art of listening, it will give you the footing to nudge them to maybe a new perspective. Sometimes that happens within the same conversation, but it's rare. Jesus was God, so that doesn't count. But oftentimes, you will have to build up a relationship with somebody. This is how you show you actually care about them. And you do all these first five things. And sometimes it takes months, sometimes it takes years, but eventually an opportunity will arise and God will present you the opportunity to nudge them with the gospel. And for many people, you will be the only version of the gospel that they see done well, if you learn how to master the art of listening. See, I told you it wasn't really fair that Jesus got away with this conversation into nudging them. It wasn't until after he listens and inquires and does all those things with the blind beggar. It's after that that he says, go and have your sight, right? But another example is the Apostle Paul, who was not fully God, so it's a better example and probably more practical for our purposes. But Paul is in Acts 17, he's in Athens, and this is what happens. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you're ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. See, what we recognize here is Paul, before he proclaimed the truth, he walked around and looked carefully. He surveyed the world he was in, and he got to know the culture. He got to know who he's talking to. He learned to speak the language of the people he was interacting with. And doing all these first five things will help you to speak the language of the people that you're trying to interact with, the people that you're trying to know. I always suggest the book, The Five Love Languages by Gary Chapman, because everybody feels and receives and hears love in different ways and are affirmed in different ways. And these steps help you learn how to love people well, how to listen well, how to get to know them well and speak in their language. And that gives you the relational equity to then be able to nudge them. And so Paul then proclaims this truth. And he says, here we go. He says, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. He's going, I've seen all the things that you worship. I've seen your temples. You even have an idol with an inscription to an unknown God. Let me tell you about him, because I know his name. And because he looked carefully and walked around and learned to speak the language of the people where he was at, it gave him the immediate ability to be able to speak truth into the situation and to say, hey, this unknown God, he's better than all the others because this is the one true God and he's not contained or served or built by human hands. He is the author of life. And he's able to present the gospel to these people for the very first time because he was silent first and learned to speak the language of those around him. Listening is one of the hardest things to do, but when you do it well, when you learn how to listen well, then it will change the lives of those you interact with. It'll separate you from everybody else because very few people understand how to do this well. It's the best way to radically grab the attention of those that you intend to bless, and it's the quickest way to build trust. Master the art of listening. You know this is true because you yourself gravitate towards the people in the room that make you feel validated, that see you, that help you feel understood, and that give you room to be yourself, that listen to you. You gravitate to those people naturally. And if you become that person, you will wield influence in people's lives and you will build trust in their lives so that when the Spirit does nudge you to present the gospel, you're going to have a little bit of equity to be able to have that conversation. It'll set you up for success in all of your relationships, and it'll help you to glorify God better. The ripple effects of Paul proclaiming the gospel in Athens was that it changed the entire face of Greece and the Greco-Roman world in the first century. The church thrived because of the ministry of Paul, because he practiced this over and over and over again. And in fact, if you notice, Paul doesn't even share the whole Bible with them at first. He just shares about the resurrection. If we go on to verse, 32, it says, when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. So because Paul learned to speak their language, he gave room for that first, and then he spoke truth into their lives, it radically changed the face of the planet because it only grew from there. There's something really important about all these examples, and whether it's Paul or whether it's Jesus, there's something really important that we see repeated over and over and over again, but if we're not paying attention, we'll miss it because it's very subtle. It's the first step to listening well. Last week, we started this whole series off with the first principle of blessing your neighbor, which is to begin with prayer. And listening is actually probably the biggest component of prayer. I know when we think of prayer, we don't think about listening because we think, well, prayer is a conversation with God. But in any other conversation that you have with people, conversation is a two-way thing. You have to give room for the other person to speak. And it's often in the silence where God speaks to us and he prompts us. And it's in the silence where we feel his nudging for us to maybe pray for a person or go and approach a person. And how are we ever going to hear God? Too often we're, God, help me with this. Help this situation. Be with that person. Thank you for this. Thank you for that. Then we move on. Check. Prayer done. But we haven't stopped long enough to listen to maybe what God's trying to nudge us with. And we miss opportunities. Prayer is just as much about listening as it is about talking. And so there are two types of listening. There is listening to others, and there's listening to God. And in both regards, if we want to master the art of listening well, we first have to master the art of being silent. And if we can begin to be comfortable with silence, that's the very first step to mastering the art of listening well. This is so radical because our world is so noisy. But if you ever want to stand out from the noise, you have to master the art of being silent and being comfortable in the silence. Otherwise, it's going to be really difficult to listen to anyone. If we want to know the best way to listen to our neighbors, we must first begin with prayer and listen to God's voice in our lives. At the very end of the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus is teaching, he says this. He says, whoever hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, it's like a wise man who built his house on the rock, but everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice, it's like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. When a storm came, it came crashing down. Our ability to obey is directly related to our ability to hear. And listening to God is what grounds our ability to love others like God. If you want to find out what it is you should hear and obey, I encourage you, maybe that's where you need to pick up in your prayer time this week. Go and read Matthew 5, 6, and 7, where Jesus preaches the Sermon on the Mount. But church, you are often the closest representation that the people around you will see of the gospel because we are his hands and feet. And by the way we listen to others, by the way we bless others, that's how people will know our God. The unknown God that other people serve will be seen through you. So my challenge for you, in order to move from hoping the gospel blesses someone to helping it bless someone, is to listen to one person's story this week. You know, and I'm not saying that you have to walk up to your neighbor while they're mowing the lawn and be like, hey, tell me your life story today, right? They may not be in the mood for that, but you can go and engage. You can go and inquire. Say, hey, how was your day today? And really mean it. And dig in a little deeper. Oh, well what happened then? What was going on? And you may not hear their whole story. You may only hear a chapter. But maybe, just maybe, once they get going, you'll hear a lot more. You'll learn more about their story. You'll learn more about the people who are around you. And if we can master the art of listening in our own lives, it can transform our neighborhoods. It can transform our counties. It can transform our workplaces. And I believe that it can transform the world. Father, we love you and we thank you for the opportunity to come here this morning to study your word and to look to you as our example. I ask that you would help us just to live and walk humbly with you and to learn to be okay and comfortable with the silence, to give breathing room for you to speak and breathing room to allow others to feel heard and understood. Help us to be an accurate reflection of your love this week as we go out into our communities and into our jobs and into our busy routines once again. Some of us, as we go on to vacation for fall break, I ask that you would help us to be attentive to the people around us, see people as opportunities. We thank you for your Son and his price, the price that he paid on the cross for us. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. If you would like to continue the conversation with somebody, if you have questions about our church or about faith or about anything at all, you can head to our Next Steps room that's out in the lobby. Or if you're watching online, then I encourage you to text this number, text NEXT to 317-576-2288, and we'll get you connected with someone. We'll be able to talk with you. We'll help you feel heard, and we'll really care and mean it. As we dismiss today and you guys go out to the community, remember that we don't just go to church, but we are the church everywhere we go.